All this afternoon on this web talk, and I'm accompanied by my colleague Dr. Reena.
Hello.
Who is also a subject matter expert on ergonomics and office ergonomics especially. Before we start the webinar, there is a small instruction for you. We have a small window on the screen where you can post your questions, and we'll be able to answer them as and when we towards the closure of the webinar, we'll be able to take those questions. So we start with the subject of today's afternoon discussion on seating kills. Today, you know, there's a lot of talk on the internet, a lot of popular media across the globe trying to talk about the subject of is seating really killing people. So the more you go on the web and the more you read it, the more you find it. Very simply trying to say that, okay, a lot of people are talking about it on the net, on the web. And the biggest question that is there with us today is it true? Can seating on a chair really kill you? We as experts on the panel with Godrej and the subject of ergonomics, we get a lot of curious of, okay, is seating really that bad? Or how difficult it is to sit for long, and how it's going to impact me as an individual? Is it good for my health, not good for my health? All those questions definitely come across to us. The other question that people come back and again ask is it really that serious? Is it really an overkill? So when we look at it, the whole idea is, you know, we must generally look at some evidence, some stories, some real facts about it. So is it that really evidence-based support that seating is really that dangerous that it's going to kill you, or is going to be very dangerous for you as an exercise itself? So when we are looking at a subject of seating killing you, is it really that the subject which is there only being talked about today, or is there some history, or somebody in the past has also done some studies, some research on that? While preparing for this webinar, I came across a very interesting piece of history. Somebody in 1700 AD in Italy, somebody called Ramazzini, he was a physician, did talk about diseases in workspaces. And what did he talk about was 52 different type of occupations relating to odd postures. He was talking about diseases leading to some difficult issues happening to people at workspaces, all those things. And he had a very specific point to talk about people who are sitting. And in 1700s, he did point out very, very, very crisply in one sentence that those who sit at their work suffer from their own peculiar diseases. So in 1700, there was a documented evidence of somebody talking about sitting, and definitely some dangers associated, you know, associated with that. So when we are talking about that in history, is there some evidence that is scientifically proven that what exactly goes wrong if you sit for long? Is there something which is really possible for us to prove? So when we do that, there are like dozens of massive researches happening globally on the impact of sitting on individual and their health and their productivity, their longevity of life, and the possibility of death as well. So when that's happening, you look at these researches where people are talking about diabetes, they're talking about cardiovascular diseases, people talking about metabolic risk, they're talking about cancer and decrease in life expectancy of people across whoever is sitting for long. But that's a global research, right? So when we in Godrej start to look at this thing, we also conducted a good amount of research on that. I'm going to share with you, say, a slide or two on that, trying to say that, okay, what is happening in the Indian context? When you look at Indian offices, Indian people who are sitting for long hours of time, what is happening, or how is it impacting them as a whole, as a bunch of people, how is it impacting us as Indians? When you do that research, we definitely came out with a few interesting facts, saying that, okay, people are sitting for close to around 13 hours in a day. So people are sitting beyond 13 hours in a day sometimes. People are sitting continuously close to around 2.5 hours in a day on their chairs in offices for sure. So people are sitting for long, long, long amount of time. People are not exercising at all. People are not exercising. They are not active in their lifestyles at all. And a very interesting fact, 95% of people actually do not know that they are at a risk, or they are at a danger of something happening to them if they sit for long. And what is the impact? How does it impact them? close to 70% of people have some other complaint happening to them. Either it's related to their neck pain, it's related to their wrist pain, shoulder pain, back aches, all those things happening to them over a period of time because they are sitting either long hours of time or they are sitting incorrectly. So that's what is happening to them. So what does it mean? So if you look at the history of the historical research, if you look at the research happening globally, if you look at the Godrej research that's happening, it clearly talks about one thing, that sitting for long and less of physical activity is dangerous to people. So I think there's no surprise to it. But the fact of matter is, people sit, all of us sit and sit at home, we sit at leisure, we sit watching TV, we sit watching movies for hours together, we sit in our cars, we sit in public transport, we go to our office and sit again, in chairs, in cafeteria, in meeting rooms, anywhere we find a place, we are just sitting. So when we are just sitting for long hours of time, there are two theories which actually emerge. One is that you will end up having some musculoskeletal disorder which will be linked to your immediate pain in your body and will have a long-term impact. The other is linked to obesity and things leading to diabetes, leading to cardiovascular issues and impacting your life expectancy altogether. So there are two theories which actually work, different set of people impacted with different consequences, and that's how it all looks like. Majority of people, whoever understands this, is interested to understand this subject, definitely understand there is some amount of change required, and almost everyone agrees to it. So after we have agreed to a fine saying that okay, some change is required, you know, whatever we are doing is probably not correct. So what do we do? So I will recommend a very interesting TED talk to all of you. It was delivered by somebody called Nilofer Merchant over a year back. It talks about a very interesting thing. It says, it's a very interesting concept. It talks about if you have a meeting, take a walk. So how do you have walking meetings is what she is trying to propagate from her TED talk. Very interesting piece of communication if you go and see it. It's quite interesting. But right, coming back to our topic. So if everyone agrees to that, program, see, some change is required. So what's the right way forward now? What do you do about it? Do you change all your workstations to standing desk, or you put treadmills to every workstation and ask people to exercise? How does it look like? You know, if you are to tomorrow being asked to shift to something like this, would it really help? Does it help? There are some other issues as well. I'll come back to you on this in a minute. There are some issues linked to culture. So will having a treadmill in your office and jogging on it while working, will it be too casual for people? Will it be too informal? Will it disturb the ecosystem in where we work? Those are a few questions that are there. There are things linked to cost. So the minute you start to have infrastructural changes in your large or massive setups, it's going to have an impact on cost, which is going to have far-reaching consequences from different stakeholders across the company. And the biggest of all, the challenges as we would talk about, is change is never easy. Change is never easy. So when you're talking about change in the whole work setup for lakhs and lakhs of people across the country, where you're asking everybody to now tomorrow stand up and start working, is it really feasible for people to do that? So as I said, change is never easy. And imagine when people were sitting on wooden chairs, four-legged chairs, right? Then they got those cushion chairs which were allowing them to tilt and work. People shifted from paper-based systems to computers. So when that change happened and people continued to sit, right? They were sitting on four-legged chairs to chairs which were reclining and comfortable and cushiony and all those things. But believe me, we are still struggling in our own existing setups to find a right way to sit. If you look at organizations or offices or people at home, you should look at how they sit. It's very difficult for people to sit correctly. Imagine close to 80% of people actually don't know how to sit correctly on the chair right now, when we've been sitting on chairs for years together. So when you ask for a change to happen, that's going to be a massive amount of disturbance for people. So when people will have more of standing, they'll probably have issues in terms of how do I stand correctly. people will talk about how do I move correctly. So if you move or if you change your setup, the change is going to be massive. And to change behaviors is very difficult because you're talking about not only infrastructure change, but change in the behavior of people as they work in those existing setups. And believe me, standing for long is also not very comfortable. People do get tired. And when you stand for a long amount of time, it can lead to very serious medical conditions, which can be linked to varicose veins. So it's not that standing is the only solution. So what do you do? That's a big question everyone has. So the idea is, if you're looking at a change in behavior of people, the only thing that works is probably something called communication. So you need to manage that change by creating awareness among people, trying to tell them that, okay, boss, if you don't do it from today, you'll probably have to have a long-term damage to yourself. So when you do that, if you communicate that or create that awareness among larger set of people, probably that change will start to happen slightly, dramatically, to a certain extent, where people start to believe. Because changing only the infrastructure may not be the right answer, because only infrastructure doesn't help. Infrastructure, phased infrastructure with awareness of people. So that is probably the right way forward. So what Godrej took an initiative close to 3 years back, trying to create a similar awareness with people, trying to reach out to them, trying to tell them that, okay, there are some things that you need to take care of yourself in trying to reach out to people. Today, with this initiative, we reached close around 8 lakh people across different organizations every week with a new information. And the information today looks something like this, that you probably need to take a small health break. Do not continue to sit on your desk for a long amount of time. Even if you're sitting on your desk, how can you be more active? How can you be more finding some opportunity to stretch? How do you stretch? How do you find that fitness quotient into yourself, into your life, in your office behavior, in your work behavior, at your homes as well, trying to say that, okay, how can you be more active and be fit enough? And not fall in that trap of musculoskeletal disorders or some other issues happening to them over a long period of time. And today we partner with lots and lots and lots of organizations, work with them on different issues linked to such behavioral changes, addressing very specific issues linked to those organizations. We are working with organizations trying to say that, okay, if you want to migrate to something called a standing desk, how do you do that? You cannot do it overnight. You can't ask everybody to start standing on their feet and start to work, say, 8 hours in a day. So how do you migrate it in a phased manner from step 1 to step 4 in 2 years of time? How do you migrate into a far better working environment and half with a far better healthy office? So how do you do that? So that's the change of management of from a say existing office to a slightly healthy office. How do you do that transition? So that's what is being managed very carefully. So before I close, I thought I'll share with you and leave this slide for a few seconds for you to go through. I find this Dilbert clip very interesting, and I thought I'll share with you during this webinar. So if you're interested to know more about this subject, if you have any queries related to your office ergonomics, your fitness quotient in workplace, your fitness quotient at home, you can always write back to us at wellness@godrej.com. There is a team of experts who are here impaneled with us, who will be able to probably answer all your questions. You can also follow us at Wellness at Work Live on LinkedIn. Any questions you might have, you can always pin them down on this communication chat window down below, and we'll be able to answer the questions for you. We are waiting for those questions to get in front of me, for me to have a look, and me and Dr. Reena can answer those questions for you. With the query saying that, okay, I am working on my laptop daily around 3 to 4 hours. Now for a few days I am facing severe pain in my neck. A lot of people suggest me that it's due to wrong sitting. So can you suggest me some proper way of sitting? This is from Hemant. Hi Hemant, I think that's a very typical question that you've asked, and a lot of people do definitely come back with such curious to ask. I'll add my perspective to it and also ask Dr. Reena to share the comments. See, the idea is, if you sit, if you use a laptop for 3 to 4 hours, 3 to 4 hours of time, as in case, say in front of me right now, the challenge is the screen is always lower than my eye height. And the minute I look and start to work on it like this, I am probably going to create I'm probably going to create a neck angle which is supposed to be bending forward like this, and my back is also not going to be supported on my chair. So I'll have to always sit like this and work for long hours of time if I have to work for 3 to 4 hours at a stretch every day. So that's going to be difficult for me. Reena, you want to comment on that?
Right. Even if it is possible that you can take breaks after every 30-35 minutes or 40 minutes, that is advisable, and regular exercise is very important.
It's advisable that you, apart from the ergonomic guidelines, you also take breaks for almost after every 35-40 minutes, and also a part of regular exercise regime is important.
Also, I would want to say that get yourself an external keyboard and mouse if you could. What does it do? It suddenly opens up the space. Instead of cramping yourself into a small keyboard like this in front of you as a keyboard for laptop, it allows you to open up suddenly, and then what it does is it allows you to go back into the chair and occupy a right posture as you type and work. So that's probably a right posture to work. So get yourself an external keyboard and mouse, and that will probably help you to get a slightly better posture. Keep a few old diaries if you could on below the laptop. So it also raises the screen for you and is not really below the eye level. So that's how it probably works. So 3 or 4 things, as she said. You need to probably take more number of breaks as you work on laptop. Get yourself an external keyboard and mouse. It allows you to go back and suddenly open up your shoulders and work slightly better. And keep a few bunch of rough papers and sheets or some old diaries just to raise the screen level for you to match your eye level. So that's how probably a right sitting posture would be for you.
And also, I would just add one more point on this. When a person is traveling, it becomes difficult for a person to carry the laptop stand or external keyboard and mouse. So at that time, maybe you can use it for a shorter period of time, and you might keep your bag, laptop on your bag, so that just a level is raised. You are not bending your neck for a longer period of time.
Yeah. So we'll take the next question. It says, is this webinar first of series? This is an interesting subject. Suggest you create more awareness on this. This is somebody called Ashish. Hi Ashish, thanks for the feedback. We are starting with a series of these happening over a set frequency or period of time. We will be doing that, but we'll announce it as and when it happens, but definitely we do have a plan of doing more of these going forward in future. And if you're interested on this subject, you can definitely reach out to godrejinterio.com, our own website. There's a complete section on wellness wherein we definitely talk about different issues linked to your nutrition, your health, your working habits, not only in office but also at home for your kids. So there are different subjects that get covered over a plethora of different topics, so you can definitely go about reaching out to them. But yes, we'll also continue to have this discussion going forward as we do this talk. Okay, we have one more very interesting question. How long should a person sit continuously? What time interval should you change your position? You want to answer this, Serena? I think you'll probably be the right
as
person.
As the query from Hemant, it was been answered that ideally a person should not sit for more than 35 to 40 minutes at a stretch. See to it that you are changing your posture after every 40-45 minutes. It is advisable for a normal posture to change the posture very often. But many a times, if it is not possible, you can, sitting continuously, you can, even in static postures, you can change your postures very often.
The simplest of all fact is, in the best of all positions, when you lie down and go to sleep, your body is the most comfortable position. even then it doesn't remain static beyond 40 minutes. It keeps turning and twisting itself. So if you force yourself onto a chair and sit for a long amount of time, your body is going to repel and say, okay, enough. I am starting to give you pain because I am not comfortable. So that's how it works. So you need to probably change your posture, get up and take a walk to the water cooler, have a glass of water, come back. But yes, 40 minutes is probably the outer side for you to sit continuously at a stretch. So that's how our recommendation would be. Okay, there's one more question. Is cushion chair best or hard base chair? So in hard base chair, I'm assuming that's a plastic chair. So that's what my assumption is. There's somebody called Mr. Prasad on this.
Prasad.
Mr. Giri Prasad. So, sir, hard chair is probably meant to be used in cafeteria where there are, say, other issues in terms of cleanliness and all those things which they need to maintain for hygiene and all those factors. But if you want to sit on a chair and work for a long amount of time, a cushion chair is always advisable. So that's how it works. So, because cafeteria chairs are hard enough and they're designed for a very specific purpose for people to start feel uncomfortable. Beyond 20 odd minutes of time, those chairs also do not have armrests which are adjustable, which can give you lumbar support, which can be adjusted. They don't generally recline. So there's some issues which are slightly more technical and more detailed. So we can take them offline. If you're interested, you can write back to us and we will do answer your question slightly more in detail then. Okay. How can you adjust perfect height or dimension for any person to set up their office? Lina, you want to comment on this? How can
we adjust perfect height
dimensions for any person to set up your office? Okay. I'll probably add a few points. Then you can add your perspective to it. See, every individual is unique. There are no two individuals who are same exactly. They don't have the same footprint. So we're all 100% different. So what happens is today we have a fixed desk. But the idea is we have a chair today in offices which is adjustable in height. So you can use the adjustability of that chair to increase the height of the chair, to increase the armrest height of the chair to support your elbows. And that's how you can make it more adaptable and adjustable to your individual requirement.
Yeah, true. And adjustability is very important. And after you adjust that, many a times it happens, you can also use external cushions or back seat fillers if the height adjustment is not sufficient for you.
Okay, we'll probably take this last question. If sitting is a problem, how can we actually take care of it? Okay. As I told you, there are no absolutes in the real world. There are always shades of grey. There is nothing which is 100% right, there is nothing 100% wrong. But yes, there are some things if you have excess of it, start to have problem. The minute you have everything in control, probably things work out well. So if you sit for limited amount of time, if you take enough breaks and you have an opportunity, say if you have a 10 people seating cluster, right? If 10 people sit in a group, and if you have one standing desk where some people who are sitting for long can take that break for half an hour, work on a standing desk, come back. So even standing for long is not healthy. Even sitting for long is not healthy. So because your body is not designed to occupy one static posture for long. So what it says is you need to have options with people for them to sit continuously and work for some amount of time. Allow them an island of standing desk where they can go and stand for half an hour, have impromptu discussion with four guys if need be. They need not be sitting around a desk and having that discussion. They can actually stand on a desk and have that discussion. So how do you create that opportunities in a working environment for people to have seating as well as standing for, and yes, you have seating desk one per individual today. Those standing islands may not be for everyone. They can be just there for, say, 1 per 10 or 20 people in office, depending on how your work styles are, but yes, that's how it should be. We have quite a lot of more questions with us. We'll do one thing, we'll probably email those responses to you, and we can take this discussion forward from there. Thanks a lot everyone for being our audience today.
Thank you.
Thanks, Reena, for contributing with your comments and responses. Thanks a lot, everyone, for being audience today. Looking forward to catching up with you forward in our further series of such webinars. Thank you.
Thank you.